We're here at the studios of Jackson ESD, and we have a special Animal Tracks presentation for you today that's about reptiles. And herpetology is the study of reptiles, and I have two people sitting next to me that are going to be our resident experts on some of these reptiles, and I'll be your talk show host, Larry Kingsnake. And so here we have on my far left Sean Nolan from Southern Oregon University, and Allyson McCauley from Southern Oregon University also. So we're going to start off and talk about reptiles in general, and they have lots of friends that they brought with them today. So let's start off right here. We've got a little friend, Allyson. Who is this, and what's he about?
Right, Steve. This is actually a she, and this is a box turtle. And box turtles are not native to Oregon, but they are found in other parts of the United States. And they get their name because, like most turtles, if they get scared, they can go inside their shell. But she also has, it's like a little hinge here, makes this like a flap or a door. So if she gets really afraid, she can pull herself in and poof, close that little door and be just like in a box. That's
you know, when you think of reptiles, you think of snakes. And how are turtles like snakes, and how are they related to each other?
Well, you're right. A lot of people do, when they hear the word reptile, the first thing they think of is a snake. But turtles have the same things in common with snakes that all reptiles have. For one thing, they have scaly skin. You can see we have a couple. This is some turtle skin and some lizard skin here. All reptiles do have scaly skin on their body.
Wow, that's pretty interesting. What are other, Sean, what are some other characteristics of reptiles before we get into more specific examples?
One of the things that a lot of people think about when they think about reptiles is that they're cold-blooded. The scientific term for that is called ectothermic. And what it means to be cold-blooded is that a reptile has a different kind of physiology. Their internal body temperature is not constant like ours is. It fluctuates with the environment. So they have to go out into the sun to heat up in order to warm up, and then they have to go to the shade to cool down in order to regulate their internal body temperature. All reptiles have to do that.
So what would they be doing? I mean, we're in the middle of May, and it's kind of a cold day today. What would they be doing to regulate their body temperature on a day like today?
Probably they would be under rocks, in the dirt, in the sand, probably hiding out, trying to conserve energy by not moving and not doing a lot of activity. Right. But it is kind of cold today.
Yeah. But so then Allyson, if the sun does come out, they're going to go find the nice big rock they can find, or maybe sometimes you'll even see snakes out on the highways or something, because it's nice and black and they can absorb the heat that way.
So typically, do you find more reptiles in tropical areas?
Yes, actually you do, Steve. Some of the largest, heaviest bodied reptiles in the world will be found in the tropics. Okay. Also a lot more diversity of reptiles.
Allyson has something else here, some eggs, which have another characteristic that is common to reptiles.
Right. Reptiles do lay eggs, and this egg is what enabled reptiles to move away from the water. They don't have to lay their eggs in water like fish, obviously, and like amphibians do. This is a watertight egg. It's not hard like a chicken egg. It's kind of soft. These are actually a little dry, but when they're living, they're kind of soft and leathery. Mm-hmm. And the mother will lay them down in the dirt. And there are a few reptiles, a few snakes that retain the eggs, but most of them are egg layers.
So they lay them in moist areas, or can they lay them pretty much anywhere?
Pretty much anywhere, depending upon the habitat of the reptile.
Right. So. Okay. What's another characteristic of reptiles? We've talked about three so far.
Well, also one more characteristic that people sometimes forget is that reptiles live on land and they breathe air. They have lungs, so they breathe air. Fish are cold-blooded. They have scales in their body and they also lay eggs. But they get their oxygen from the water, whereas reptiles are found on land.
So. Great. So those four common characteristics for all reptiles.
Mm-hmm.
So what else you have to share with us? You got some friends that you can bring out?
Yeah.
And Sean has his little friend, Mr. Kingsnake.
Yeah.
Tell us about the kingsnake.
Well, this is a beautiful snake.
This is
the California mountain kingsnake. It's common to our area here in southern Oregon. The California mountain kingsnake is a brightly colored snake. It has the red, yellow, and black bands on it. Sometimes it's mistaken for a poisonous species of snake called the coral snake. But here in Oregon, here in southern Oregon, we don't have the coral snake. Coral snakes are found in the southeastern parts of and southwestern parts of the United States.
So if you're walking in the woods here, you're probably, if you see something this color, you're probably talking about a kingsnake.
Mm-hmm.
How is it different from a coral snake?
Well, that's a good question. How do you tell the difference when they both have the same color bands? that has to do with the pattern of the bands. If you'll notice on here, the red band touches the black band. There's a nice little saying that can remind you that red next to black is a friend of Jack. Red next to black will let you know that this snake is a non-venomous king snake. Now the coral snake, which is found down in parts of Arizona, has the red next to the yellow. The red band is next to the yellow band, and we like to refer to that as red next to yellow can hurt a fellow. So if you don't remember the saying that red next to black is a friend of Jack and red next to yellow will hurt a fellow, then the best thing to do is just to kind of leave it alone.
What if your name's not Jack? Are they still friendly?
I don't know. That's totally up to the person who's looking at the snake. Yeah. Now, king snakes have a pretty neat name, if you think about it. The king snake has a name that's kind of prestigious, if you think about it. To be called king, you have to have sort of a reason that goes behind it. The king snakes get their name because they'll kill and consume other reptiles, other snakes, including rattlesnakes.
Really? So how can they withstand being bitten by a venomous snake like a rattlesnake?
That's a good question. They have an immunity that's built up against rattlesnake venom that they've evolved over time.
Uh-huh.
If a rattlesnake were to bite them, it would actually wouldn't hurt them.
Great. Anything else you want to share with us? Or I know we've got some questions called in, but anything else about a king snake before we move on to a rubber boa?
No, that's about it.
Well,
here's a question.
Here's a question, and it says, what's the most poisonous snake in the world?
That's a good question. The most poisonous snake in the world can be found off the coast of off the coast of Australia. In Australia, we have a snake called the sea snake, the yellow-bellied sea snake. Drop for drop, it has the most toxic venom of any snake in the world.
Wow, I'm glad they don't live here.
It's a good thing.
Okay.
I'm going to go ahead.
Rubber boa. Thank you, Mr. King Snake.
No
Thank
problem.
You, Sean. And Allyson has then a rubber boa.
Right,
tell us about the rubber boa and what's unique about it.
Well, one of the things that's really special about the rubber boa is that they are one of only two species of the boa family that are found in the United States. And this is the only one that's found in Oregon.
Really?
And they're found throughout Oregon. They get their name because they look kind of rubbery.
Yeah.
They have the same scales that all other reptiles have. They burrow. So they spend a lot of time down under the ground.
Yeah.
They're also sometimes nicknamed two-headed snakes.
Yeah, can we get a shot of that?
Yeah.
The tail of that? Look at the head and the tail.
A lot of people will ask me if this snake has had his tail chopped off or chewed off or something. And this is the way their tails grow. They're kind of blunt like that. And sometimes if they're attacked by a predator, what they will do is they'll coil in a ball and hide their head. And they'll even act like they're striking with this tail. And it kind of diverts attention. And if they get bitten on the tail, they might be able to escape. But if they get bitten on the head, they're never going to make it.
Well, that's pretty interesting. How do they eat their prey? If they're not poisonous, if they don't have big teeth, how do they get food?
Almost all snakes that are non-venomous are constrictors, which means that they will constrict their prey. Now, they don't crush it to death,
which is
what a lot of people think. Right. They'll bite it and wrap around, and what they do is they suffocate the animal.
They
squeeze tightly enough that the animal can't get any air in its lungs.
Wow. And so what kinds of things might a rubber boa eat?
Oh, they eat lots of different things. They'll eat insects and snails and sometimes even small birds and other snakes.
But primarily they
eat small rodents like mice.
But how do they get them in their mouth when their mouth's pretty small? A small rodent's much bigger than their mouth.
Right, right. Snakes can actually eat things that are three times the size of their head. So it'd be like you eating a watermelon in one gulp or a bowling ball or something like that. They have special tendons in their jaw that enables them, instead of opening their mouths like this, they can actually open their mouths like that.
Huh.
So they can sort of crawl over whatever it is that they're trying to eat.
And I guess if you don't have any hands, that's the only way you can do it
if you can't use a knife and a fork.
Yeah.
Right.
Do they have teeth that go back and forth to help move the
Yes.
food?
They also, their jaw right here is not joined in the middle. And so they can push one side forward and then the other side and sort of crawl over the food that they're eating. So.
Great. Well, Sean's just handed us a question, and I think that, here's another poisonous snake question. How many poisonous snakes are in southern Oregon?
That one's a real easy one. We have 15 species of snake in Oregon, and of that, only one species is venomous, and that's the western rattlesnake.
Right.
Very easy to recognize because they have that broad head, and of course they have the rattle. And that's designed to warn you, because they don't want to bite you if they can help it, because they're trying to save their venom to get their food.
Right.
So.
Great. Well, Sean's going to bring on somebody else, and we're going to encourage you to call. Been getting quite a few calls so far, but we'd like to encourage you to call into the questions that you have about reptiles, snakes, lizards, caimans, alligators, turtles, any of those categories of critters that we're sharing with you here today. And here's a question. What's the largest reptile? Allyson, what's the largest reptile?
There are large members of each species, but the overall reptile that weighs the most and is the longest is a saltwater crocodile. They can weigh over 1,000 pounds and be up to almost 20 feet long.
Yeah. Well, Sean's got something here for us, and this guy's pretty active, and I'll have to say he makes me a little nervous. What do you got here, Sean?
That's rightly so. This snake is often confused in southern Oregon for a rattlesnake, but just to make you comfortable, I'll let you know that it's not a rattlesnake.
Yeah.
This is a bull snake, not found directly here in Oregon, but there's a relative of the bull snake called the gopher snake that's found around here. A lot of times when people see this snake, the gopher snake looks very similar to this bull snake.
Yeah, the coloration's pretty similar.
Yeah, that pattern on their skin is real similar. It's real similar to that of a rattlesnake that's found here in Oregon. The rattlesnake is the only venomous snake that's found here in Oregon. Now, the gopher snake is a harmless species of snake that doesn't have any venom that will kill rodents. And a lot of times when people confuse it, it's because they see the pattern on their skin, and then also when this snake gets kind of confused, when it gets scared or feels threatened, it'll flatten its head, it'll coil in a coil, and it'll shake the end of its tail just like a rattlesnake will. But if you'll notice, at the end of the tail here, there's something missing. There's not a rattle at the end of that tail.
Is it a constrictor also? Does it constrict its prey?
Yes, it does.
Okay.
It does constrict its prey. It'll grab hold of its prey, squeeze it, stop it from breathing, and then swallowing it whole.
Is this a pretty large bull snake?
Yes, this
is. It seems like it.
Yeah, this particular individual is about 6 feet long.
And how old, do you have any idea of how old it might be?
This one is over 7 years old, but I don't know the complete.
That's an old snake.
Yeah,
tell us about, how do you differentiate between male and female snakes?
Well, I'll actually show you that a little bit later.
A little later,
On some of the other snakes I brought. It's a little bit more difficult on this kind of snake because it has to do with the cloaca opening, which I'll show you a little bit later.
Okay, great. Okay. Well, we're back on a live call-in program for Animal Tracks, and Sean's going to put his friend, the bull snake, who's not my best friend, away. And we've got a couple more questions, and Allyson's, I think, got a fence lizard. We haven't seen a lizard before, and she's going to share with you a lizard. But first, a question. Do king snakes eat birds?
As far as I know, king snakes will eat birds. They don't just eat other snakes. They will eat rodents as well, and small birds, and maybe even some eggs, and when they're smaller, insects, like other reptiles.
You know, I haven't mentioned some of the names. That was from Calvin, and Billy Harvey called in the first question, and Kelly Barton, I think, from Eagle Point, called in the first question that we got. So we'd like to recognize your name on air and make sure that you get your questions answered.
Okay.
Allyson, what do we have here? This is a little fence lizard, right?
Right. Let's see if I can catch these guys right here.
Oh, you got two of them in there.
That's not the one I want. Yeah, here we go. Got a little sand in my hand. These are western fence lizards. They're found throughout Oregon.
Right.
You might see them sometime out on a rock somewhere, basking in the sun if you're out walking near Immigrant Lake or Klamath or any place like that. And their nickname is Blue Belly. And
because
if I turn this little guy over,
look at that blue color.
You can see they really have a brilliant blue color on their bellies.
That's great, kind of a racing stripe too.
Right, right. If you do see these guys, I've never known one to bite, so if you wanted to try and pick it up and take a look at it, you could, but you want, of course, be very careful that you don't squish them or that you don't grab them from the tail, because their tail will break off.
I have a funny story to tell about a fence lizard. Yeah. We were out looking for lizards one day early in the morning because they weren't moving very fast, and we kicked over a rotten log. It crawled up my pants leg, and I caught it right about there. I had to go behind
a bush.
Did
you have a blue belly?
I had a very blue face, I'll tell you that. All Okay, Western fence lizard.
Oh, let me tell you one other neat thing about these guys. There's probably no way you're going to be able to see that, but they have a small little circle on the top of their head, and it's called a pineal organ.
Uh-huh.
And that's a light sensing organ, sometimes called a pineal eye,
right.
Not actually an eye, but they can sense the direction of light that way, and so they can orient themselves to the sun if they need to warm up or if they need to cool down a little bit. All right, let me put this guy back away.
Great. We've got some questions. Sean, if you want to hand me a couple of questions,
yeah,
and
we'll
start off on that. I know you've got another critter to get out. This is from Jackie, and I'm not sure I can read the last name, Clark. And what's the smallest reptile, Allyson?
Ooh, boy, that's a tough one.
That's a good question. I'm sure there's some lizards.
Yeah.
Some small lizards that would be very, very small. You know, fence lizards and sagebrush lizards don't get much bigger than that. One of the smallest snakes you will ever see around this area is called a ringneck snake.
Uh-huh.
And they're pretty small and skinny, and they have the little ring around their neck.
Okay.
So probably some type of lizard or snake.
This question is from Danny Bray, and what's the most endangered snake? Boy,
that's
tough questions,
question.
You guys. Most endangered snake.
I'm going to ask Sean if he knows.
Yeah, one of the most endangered species of snakes is the eastern indigo snake.
Oh, right. The eastern indigo snake is a beautiful snake that's found down in the southeastern United States. And it's they actually are the longest native snake to the U.S. They can get over 10 feet. And they've got a beautiful color, and they're very docile. They almost never bite, so they've just been over-collected. People take them as pets.
Uh-huh. So. Okay.
All right, well,
we're going to come back, and I think Sean's going to come on with this one. Makes me this one's very active. I don't know if you can get that, but this is a caiman, and he's making some hissing sounds. I think he'd rather be someplace else, and I think I might rather be someplace else too.
I can see why. That's
okay,
right, Steve.
Down
this,
boy.
This is a South American caiman. Caimans are relatives to the alligators,
right.
And crocodiles. This particular species will get to be about maybe 6 or 7 feet long,
uh-huh.
and about 40 or 50 pounds. It's a rather young individual, as you can see.
I'm really happy about that. I'd hate to have a 10-year-old caiman on the show here.
Well, one of the reasons why this guy is really aggressive, he's looking for you there, Larry.
Yeah, down boy.
One of the reasons why this guy is really aggressive has to do with his age.
Uh-huh.
He is a younger, only about 5 or 6 years old, caiman that in the wild would be food for a lot of different kinds of animals. So he's really kind of defensive. He's showing off that row of razor-sharp teeth.
Thank you. That's reassuring.
He's got that mouth wide open to let you know that he'll grab hold of it if he gets a chance.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Tell us a little bit about where they live. And these aren't native to Oregon, right?
No, they're not native to Oregon.
Thank
That's a
you,
good,
Sean.
Good question. Alligators and crocodiles are only found in the United States. In parts of Louisiana, the South, including Florida, there's a lot of species of alligators that live down there. Well, there's only one species of alligator that lives down there, a lot of individuals. This particular one is found farther down to South America, so we won't have any that live here in Oregon.
Yeah. Their tail's pretty predominant. How do they use their tail?
Well, that's a good question. That tail has a rudder like thing on it. This enables the animal to live in the water. Spends a lot of its time in the water.
Right.
It enables it to really propel itself through the water.
Yeah.
In fact, all the alligators and crocodiles and caiman are found in and around water sources, rivers, slow-moving streams, lakes, ponds, including ocean estuaries. They get all their food from those areas. Animals coming down to get a drink of water, or including fish and other aquatic animals.
I'd like to be making better eye contact with the camera, but it's hard for me to take my eyes off him.
Well,
is this the one that you were going to show us, the difference between males and females?
No, actually, that's on a little bit
later.
Oh,
gosh, I keep getting confused.
That's okay. One of the things that's cool about alligators and crocodiles, I know, he's a bit jumpy.
I am, too.
That's understandable. You wouldn't want to put your hand down there.
I saw that white eyelid thing come up. What happened there? Should I be real calm?
Actually, you're okay. I mean, I won't let him get to you. You did see an eyelid. What's neat about the alligators and crocodiles is they have three eyelids. They have one to wipe away some of the dirt that gets on their eyes. They have two. The second one is actually used to close to block out sunlight so they can sleep. And then the third is really kind of neat. It creates an airspace between the eye and the water, and allows them to see like a scuba mask. Uh-huh. It's really kind of neat.
Right.
Yeah.
It's kinda, so that's a caiman. Anything special about their eyes?
Those
eyelids so they can see underwater.
One thing you'll notice too is this guy is a young individual and he'll get to be huge. He'll get to be about 6-7 feet long. They don't make good pets at all.
Yeah, I was going to ask that. I wouldn't want this guy around my house.
Yeah, this particular kind of animal will sometimes be seen in pet stores.
Yeah.
They are not very good.
Yeah.
Very good animals. All right. Looks like you have some questions.
Yeah, we have some questions. So
I'll move them over here.
Okay,
for
thanks.
You.
So I can reach the table here. This is Jeff Schwender, it looks like. And how long can a Western rattlesnake go without eating?
That's a really good question. Snakes. Hold on.
Down boy.
Snakes and reptiles can go for long periods of time without eating because of their physiology, because they're cold-blooded or ectothermic. The longest on record for a snake going without eating was 2 years. Now that's not normal. That's because the snake was feeling sick or during a breeding season. Whoops. Sorry, Steve. Sorry. And because it goes for a long period of time without eating, it was able to survive. It went for up to 2 years and then started eating again, and it was actually okay.
Great. Well, we're back at the studios of Jackson ESD with our live animal show called Animal Tracks. And I think, Sean, if you'd put the caiman away, we'll bring out something else that we can focus on. Let me ask another question. Are you ready, Allyson, for a couple questions?
I'll do my best.
Okay, this is from, looks like, Beth Howard. How many eastern indigo snakes are there? Oh my gosh.
Yeah. Y'all are really testing us today.
252.
Yeah, 5,300. Now, there's no known number because it's impossible for them to go out and count all the individuals, and I don't even know what the exact estimate is, but there are not very many. I know herpetologists in the southeastern United States who go out looking for them, and they know where to look, and they have trouble finding them, but I don't know a specific number.
Let's do one more question before you bring out your next guest. This is from Selena, it looks like. How do snakes eat insects?
Do all
snakes eat insects?
Right. A lot of snakes will eat insects when they're small because it's easy to catch them and swallow them, but not all snakes will. There are some snakes that live in the water that spend their entire life eating fish, and other snakes that are going to eat primarily eggs, like the egg-eating snake.
Right.
You can get a hint from that name there.
That's a clue.
But a lot of snakes will eat insects, particularly when they're smaller.
Uh-huh.
So.
Great. Well, let's go to your next friend. We have a couple more questions we'll hold until after this next guy.
Yeah, we'll get him out here.
Yeah, look at him.
Yeah, he's a big... There we go.
Ooh, talk about the tongue. That's pretty common to all the reptiles, isn't it?
Right, it sure is. And we haven't talked about that yet, have we? This lizard, this is a savanna monitor lizard, and he shares a characteristic with all the snakes in that he uses his tongue to smell.
Yeah.
Snakes and this kind monitor lizards will have a special organ in the roof of their mouth called a Jacobson's organ.
Mm-hmm.
It's like two slits in the roof of their mouth.
So they go out and then they put it up in the
roof
of their mouth.
Exactly. They stick their tongue out, get the molecules from the air on their tongue, take it back and kind of taste the air that way.
So do they have more sensitive sense of smell than we do with
certainly,
mechanism?
Oh, certainly.
Really?
They're going to use their tongue like we would use our eyes.
Really?
That's their way to check things out, find out about their environment, see if there's any food nearby, if there is a predator maybe, or if they're looking for a mate. They'll get all that lovely information from their tongue.
Well, tell us about a monitor lizard, because I know these get pretty large.
Right. These, as I said, this is a savanna monitor lizard, and they're found on the African savanna, as their name implies. And they are cousins to probably the most famous lizard in the world and the largest lizard in the world, which is the Komodo monitor, better known as a Komodo dragon. And Komodo dragons can get over 11 feet long. These guys will only max out at about 5 or 6 feet. But the Komodo can get up to about 11, so that's a pretty impressive lizard.
What's their skin doing? I noticed back here it's kind of had, looks like it's shedding.
Right. Snakes will usually shed, if you can hand me that right there.
Uh-huh.
Snakes will usually shed their skin in pretty much one piece, but a lot of lizards will shed it in lots of little pieces. And so he's actually, he looks kind of scrapey here and messy because he's in the process of shedding his skin. Uh-huh. And so he'll lose it a little piece at a time.
Yeah. What about the holes, the slits behind the head?
This right here on the side of his head is called a tympanum, and it's actually his ears.
Yeah.
And so he doesn't have ears that stick out of the side of his head like we do, but he does have a hole, and the sound can go in there, and he's able to hear that way. Snakes do not. That's one difference between lizards and snakes. Snakes do not have external ears, holes on the side of their head like lizards do.
Let me ask you another question that's come in. This is from Adrian Adams. How long does a snake typically live? I know that's probably specific to an individual species, but what's an average length for some snakes?
Well, the record was a boa constrictor that was confirmed to have lived 38 years.
Wow.
And so that is definitely going to be the exception. Most snakes in the wild are probably not going to live more than about 5 to 7 years or so. In captivity, animals will usually live a little bit longer because they have a more reliable food source. They're less likely to get eaten. Things like that.
What about turtles, like Galapagos turtles? They live hundreds of years, right?
Right. Some scientists think that the crocodilians, different kinds of crocodiles, and the tortoises can live maybe even over 200 years.
Wow.
The record, the longest confirmed lifespan for a turtle was a giant tortoise that was known to live 152 years.
Wow.
So they'll be here long after we're gone.
That's great. Well, we'd like to encourage you. We're getting lots of calls, and so this is really fun. You're going to put the monitor away, and Sean's coming back on, and let's see if we can hit him with a couple more questions. What's coming up next? What are you bringing out here, Sean?
Well,
this is the big guy, huh?
This is a large animal. Yes. I might need some help from Allyson here in a minute.
Oh my God! Oh, hoochie, mama. He's really pretty.
Yeah. Actually, yeah. She's quite pretty. Actually, she's doing okay. I'm gonna have a seat here.
Yeah.
Yeah, she's a really kind of a neat species of snake. This is what's called a Burmese python.
Right.
Burmese pythons are large, heavy-bodied snakes found down in parts of Southeast Asia. Other species of pythons can be found in Africa, Australia, even in parts of Indonesia. You'll see different species of pythons. This particular one will reach a length of about 25 feet long when she's fully grown.
And how long is she now?
She's only about 12 or 13 feet long
really?
Right
and
now.
And how old is she?
She is about 9 years old.
9 years?
About 9 years old.
Wow, mm-hmm. She seems pretty docile compared to some of the others.
Yeah, actually.
Is that typical? The bigger they are, the more slower moving they are?
No, not necessarily. There are some species
of
snakes.
That's reassuring.
Yeah, there are some species of snakes that get quite large that are aggressive.
Yeah.
I think one of the questions that was asked on the forum was about an anaconda.
Yeah.
Anacondas are large, heavy-bodied snakes that are like the pythons, but anacondas tend to be a little bit more aggressive. They tend to be a little bit more unpredictable on how they behave and how they react to people. The question that was asked was about the size of the anaconda.
Right.
The anacondas can reach the longest anaconda on record is 32 feet long.
Wow. Yeah. So this guy, I mean, he's a spinal column with muscles.
Mm-hmm. That's all she is she's just littered with lots and lots of ribs.
So
one big spinal
what
cord.
How do they eat their food, and what kind of food might they eat?
Well, this particular kind of snake
maybe you can get the head up a little bit.
Yeah, I'll put the head so we can see there. This snake is a constrictor.
Yeah.
She'll kill her food by grabbing hold of it, squeezing, stopping it from breathing, and then swallowing it whole.
Uh-huh.
In captivity, she'll eat things as large as 8 and 10 pound rabbits.
Wow.
In captivity. In the wild, she can eat anything from large fish to things like maybe smaller pigs.
Uh-huh. And, pigs?
Yeah, depending upon where she's from. I noticed that a lot of times you're saying that, wow, isn't he huge? Or look at the size of him.
I know, but
when we think of large animals, especially snakes, we tend to say to ourselves, wow, isn't he a big animal? Look at the size of him. He's huge. When in fact, in the world of the pythons and the boas, the females get to be almost twice as big as the boys.
Oh, really?
Mm-hmm. And that has to do with the fact that they lay a lot of eggs. The females have
Typically, how much this Burmese, how many eggs might it lay?
Oh, wow, I don't know the exact number, but
dozens?
I know that it's over 50.
Wow.
Yeah, in certain kinds.
Pretty amazing.
Over 50. One of the things you asked earlier, too, is that how do you tell the males from the females?
Right.
This is a really good one, and what I'll do is I'll go ahead and show you. I'm going to take the back end of her tail. She's probably going to crawl away a little bit, but that's okay. I want to be able to turn her around so that you can see underneath here. You can see her tail. This opening is what's called the cloaca.
Uh-huh.
Let me see that pin there for you. If you don't mind me using your pin.
No, that's fine.
right here are these little things called spurs.
Uh-huh.
They're very sharp, thorn-like things. And on the males, they're really large.
Yeah.
And if this is a male snake, it would be extended out really far. It would be almost a half inch to three quarters of an inch long. This one's really small. You can see that little spur is really spawned.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, really small. So that means that this is a female.
Yeah.
After you see a lot of the spurs, you kind of get an idea.
Have they been successful at breeding? Like pythons in captivity?
Yes, actually they have. In fact, endangered species of reptiles can be recovered in the wild quite well because they breed well in captivity depending upon the species. And reptiles aren't like mammals in the sense that they're born with everything they need to know how to survive.
Yeah.
I mean, they're ready to go. As soon as they are hatched from an egg, they're ready to go.
Well, let me ask a question if
okay.
we can sit with this guy here. This is from Alex T. What should you do if you were bitten by a poisonous snake?
Well, what you should do is you should seek medical attention. That's the first thing you should do. Sometimes when you're in areas far away, out in the hills, even in Oregon, and you were to be bitten by a rattlesnake, the first thing to do is to be calm and then also to seek medical attention if you're with somebody. But the key thing is not to panic. Reptiles here in Oregon, the venomous ones, we only have one species, which is the rattlesnake. And rattlesnakes rarely, if often, do kill people. There's a lot of people are bitten by rattlesnakes every year that do not die.
Yeah.
It's a serious bite, but it doesn't mean fatality. It doesn't
okay.
mean death. So.
Great.
Yeah.
Well, anything more that you can think of about the Burmese that we need to show? I know Allyson's got somebody crawling up on the set here. I don't know if we can get this guy, but we've got a boa up hanging there, and he's crawling up toward the light.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
Well, while we are talking about the snake that's actually crawling up towards the lights there, let me take a couple of these questions. We have very many questions.
Yeah, we
here.
Have a lot of calls in.
Two of the questions that I pulled out, one is from Sean, and the question is, what's the most popular snake for a pet? And another is from, I think it's Krena Goodman, maybe?
Uh-huh.
What is the best reptile for a pet? And we wanted to address that question with two of the snakes, one of the snakes and one of the lizards that we have here. Can we get over here to this guy here? Many people will recognize this lizard. This is Bart. And Bart was the iguana, kind of the mascot of the Pacific Northwest Museum of Natural History. And since the museum closed, he has been living, been taken care of by Southern Oregon University Youth Programs and by me since I used to work at the Natural History Museum and Sean. And we brought him, one of the reasons we brought him was to show you something about iguanas. A lot of people buy them when they're very small and plan to get them and keep them as pets, but they can really get pretty big.
Yeah.
And so they don't always make the best pets just because they get so large and also because they have very specific temperature requirements. They can get different kinds of diseases. So sometimes if you want to think this question about the best reptile for a pet, probably if you're looking to get a pet reptile, your best bet would be to get a temperate species, something that is not an exotic, not like a Burmese
right.
python. You don't want something that's going to get that big because there's no way you can
right.
have a cage big enough in your house. You don't want a boa or an iguana. Probably find yourself a corn snake or some species of smaller snake that they can sell in pet stores. And sometimes
right.
turtles make good pets too if you get some of the turtles that they sell in a pet store, or sometimes people will get turtles from humane society.
Well, tell us, while we've got the iguana up there, I assume still on camera, tell us a little bit about the iguana. What is it, where does it live? And that looks like a pretty large one.
Yeah, he's a big boy. He's about 4 feet long, and They are not, of course, found in Oregon. They're native to the tropics, native to rainforest countries. And one of the interesting things about iguanas is that they are used as a source of food in a lot of countries where they live. And so if you've heard of the tuna being called the chicken of the sea, well, we sometimes call this the chicken of the tree because they I've heard they taste like chicken. And so if you were in some of these rainforest
like
countries, instead of chicken McNuggets, you might get an iguana McNugget or something like that. A lot of people ask about these. Those are called dewlaps. And all they do is they make him, he puffs those up, and they make him look much bigger and much more aggressive.
Yeah.
So if he's looking to demonstrate or something, he will raise up like he's about to do right now, and sometimes he will bob his head up and down, and those dewlaps make him look a little more powerful, I guess.
And some iguanas live in the ocean, don't they? They're marine iguanas?
Right, in the Galapagos Islands and areas down in South America, they do have marine iguanas, and they can actually swim very well, and they feed on seaweed.
Seaweed?
Yep,
so they're vegetarians.
But these are they will eat some meat when they're younger.
Right.
But they feed primarily on fruits and leafy vegetables and things like that when they get older.
Okay, let me ask a question for Sean, unless you have something to say. This is from John. It says bamboo viper. Isn't that the most poisonous snake rather than the Australian snake?
Well, the bamboo viper is a very, very venomous snake. The bamboo vipers are very, very venomous. But they, drop for drop, the most toxic venom is still the one found in Australia. It's still that Australian sea snake. But it is very dangerous. The bamboo viper is very, very dangerous.
Right. So, this question from Jacksonville wants to know, how long does it take a rattlesnake venom to get to a fatal part of the body? Does it have to get to the heart for it to really be
fatal? Yeah, the fatalities that occur with rattlesnake bites is the blockage of the blood flow.
Right.
And if it's near the heart area, it can really stress the heart out and then and cause fatality that way.
Right.
A lot of times people are bitten on the legs or feet. These are areas where they're not as dangerous, and that's typically what happens. But for a rattlesnake bite to really be fatal, it has to get nearer, closer to the heart.
Okay, so that's good to know. Here's another question from Rachel. What should you do when you're about to be attacked by a snake? First of all, maybe you could, I think there's a misnomer that this happens all the time. What are the fatalities that are related to snakes, first of all, and then if you think that you're endangered, then what might you do?
Yeah, if you're, to keep from being attacked by a snake, here in Oregon, we only have one species of real venomous snake, which is, of course, a rattlesnake. Snakes don't look for people. They don't seek out people. They tend to avoid people. We move kind of weird. They don't like the way we move. We represent a threat. So snakes will try to avoid people every chance they get. Snakes don't typically attack people. There are some species in Africa that will chase down people to protect breeding grounds and breeding areas where they have nests or they have young. But here in Oregon, we don't have anything like that.
I would venture to say there's probably more people injured in Oregon from bee stings than there are from snakes.
Bee stings,
far
yes.
More.
Yes, far more from bee stings in Oregon than snakes.
Yeah. We want to make a quick announcement. We're getting so many calls that we're going to extend the program to 11 o'clock, and we'll try to get as many of the questions that you've called in answered. We can't guarantee that because they're coming in almost faster than we can answer them. So here's a question. This is from Jim, and he said, is there a snake that can mimic other kinds of snakes?
Well,
the bull snake you talked about kind of mimics the rattlesnake.
Yeah, actually, it'll do that. Bull snakes and gopher snakes aren't the only ones that do that. King snakes, certain species of ringneck snakes, as well as even whip snakes will actually mimic that behavior. They'll shake the end of their tail, even though there's not a rattle on there. So you could call that, it's not really calling it directly mimicking behavior, but it does. It is similar to that of a rattlesnake.
Look at the, I don't know if we can get the boa back up here on the line. What do you think he's doing there? He's on a, up in the air looking for something.
Well, the boa constrictors are really neat. They're found in South America, and they're found high up in trees.
Yeah.
Animals that live really high up in trees are what we call arboreal animals. The boa constrictor spends much of, almost all of its life high up in trees, feeding on birds or other animals that would be found foraging in the trees, getting water from bromeliads, where the water collects in those plants that are far up in the tropical rainforest.
If you want a good way to remember that word, arboreal, the best way I've found is to, if you can remember that the day that we plant trees and such is called Arbor Day. Mm-hmm. Arboreal is from a Latin word that has to do with trees. So they live up in, high in trees. And iguanas are also, or at least the green iguana, are arboreal animals.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So do we want to tell you a little bit more about this guy? This is, of course, a another type of constrictor. And the red-tailed boa can get up to about 18 feet, which is also another reason that they don't make particularly good pets, because they do get so long. And they also can get pneumonia and mouth rot and some other infections that can be kind of hard and expensive to deal with. But they really are beautiful snakes, and so if you ever have a chance to see them in zoos and places like that, it's really nice if you can go visit them in those types of places. But probably not the best bet to take one home yeah. for a pet.
Let me ask this question because it kind of relates. How can you tell a snake's age if you haven't had them since they were very young? Is there any easy way to tell?
Well, actually, it's kind of difficult to tell the age of a snake.
This
particular one, a lot of the snakes and reptiles that are found around here, you can kind of tell because of the size. The size of the animal is an indication of about approximately how old it is. But snakes have what's called indeterminate growth. They grow their whole lives, and they reach an average maximum size close to when they're going to be dying.
Yeah.
So for snakes that... Just seeing them in the wild and saying, oh, well, that's a four-year-old snake is really kind of difficult to do.
And there are some people that believe you can tell the age of a rattlesnake by the number of buttons it has on its rattle. And that's not the case because, first of all, they don't shed just once a year. And they do get a button every time they shed, but it doesn't happen just once a year. And also, they can sometimes have part of their rattle that will break off.
Yeah.
And so that's not an accurate determining factor.
Can we move on to another question?
Sure.
Yes.
This is from Brian Klinke. And what are crocodile eyelids made of? And then related to that is, how far can a snake see? How is their sense of vision?
Well, I'm going to probably answer the second one a little bit better than the first one.
I'll answer the first one.
I'm not sure what the eyelids are actually made out of other than skin tissue.
Right. It's a membrane. I assume you mean the one that is clear that they can see through, but it is a type of membrane, just a thin membrane that would be made out of the same type of scales or cells that their skin is made of.
And probably our cornea, too. Yeah. We have a clear cornea on the outside that we're able to see through. Probably comparable material, so it's clear. Whoa, boy.
she's trying to crawl away. As far as how far a snake can see, that's a pretty good question. Snakes see differently than we do, especially the pythons and the pit vipers. They see partly in infrared.
Yeah.
They use their
heat.
Yeah, they see heat. They use other organs in their head. I don't know if you can actually see her, but along the upper parts of her lip, I don't know if you can actually see up there, she has these little pits. They're located right about there. Those pits are heat-sensitive pits that allow the animal to detect warm-blooded prey.
Yeah.
So they'll see in kind of infrared. They'll see that heat mass. They'll attack that way. Their actual eyes will pick up on movement.
Mm-hmm.
But generally, snakes' vision is not that well.
Yeah.
It doesn't can't see really.
Particularly when they're getting ready to shed their skin, because they do shed the skin even that grows over their eyes. They have a layer of skin over their eyes, and so when they're getting ready to shed, their skin kind of dries out, and so their eyes will sort of cloud over. Sometimes you look at a snake and their eyes look like they've kind of got this blue color over them, and so then they're pretty much blind at that point. They don't see very well at all at that point. I wanted to point out that he was showing you the labial pits that sense heat here. Only the, not every snake has that.
Yeah.
The pit vipers have a hole to see in infrared, and the pythons have the little pits. But
I want to take a quick break and remind you that this program's on from 10 o'clock to 11 o'clock. It will be repeated if we get to some, if we don't get to all the questions by the time that we're done with the program at 11, we'll try to answer some of those questions that come in either after the show's over or ones that we don't get to. So at 1:30, there'll be another show which will be similar in that it will cover the same kind of content. Obviously, the questions will be different and there'll be a little bit different answers. But I'd like to encourage you to call in, and if you don't get your question answered on air right now, it might have to be this afternoon when we do the second show at 1:30. Here's one more question. This is an interesting one. Are there any snakes that play dead? Allyson.
There sure are. I'm from North Carolina, and we have a little snake in North Carolina called a hognose snake, and they have kind of this pointy nose, and one of the ways that they will try to avoid predators, and I've seen them do this, is you catch one, and if they discover they can't get away, they'll flip over, and they'll just hang their tongue out.
Oh, you do a good impersonation.
Thank you. It's my hog snake. And so they look like they're dead, and they'll lie there until they're convinced that danger's gone. So if you see one of these hognose snakes and they play dead, if you stand there long enough, after a while they'll flip back over and
look around,
check things out, and scoot off into the bush. But that's a good question.
That is a fun question. Okay. What's the biggest species of turtle? And this is from Zach. He wants to know, what's the biggest species of turtle? You talked about the Galapagos turtle. Is that the oldest? Is it the biggest, though?
Not necessarily. One of the biggest species of turtles that are found in a lot of the oceans is the leatherback sea turtle. The leatherback sea turtle is one of the largest turtles found in the world.
Uh-huh.
It can get to be over 1,000 pounds.
Really?
Yeah, well over 1,000 pounds. Yeah.
There's a good picture in this book that I was going to show you of the leatherback.
Yeah, we weren't able to bring one into this.
Oh, shucks. Come on. 1,000 pounds? We could handle
that. See, look at this. I don't know if you can get a picture. This is from the book Reptiles of Washington and Oregon.
Mm-hmm.
And there are many good books you can look for if you want to learn a little bit more about different kinds of reptiles.
Wow,
but if you can see, this is a leatherback turtle that washed up on shore. And you can see, compared to the people behind, it's a huge species of turtle. Very, very large. They can get 8 feet in their shell length.
This is an interesting question. How long can a snake's tongue get? I think that's going to be an estimate.
It would depend on the size of it.
Sure, but a big Burmese python or
maybe
anaconda?
Maybe two inches. Maybe
really?
2 inches,
okay.
2 or 3 inches.
It's still not coming out,
It's still not coming out. Actually,
not going to be like a chameleon or something, which has a tongue. A chameleon is a lizard that lives in, like, Madagascar, and theirs can be, like, the length of their entire body.
Uh-huh.
And they flip it out to get the insects.
The monitor lizards, the Komodo dragons from Southeast Asia, will actually have really long tongues, forked tongues.
Look, our little friend is looking for trees to go to. I don't know if we can get that on air, but he's crawling up.
Can you get him?
He's going to be in the second story of this building before we know it. Is there any kind of reptile that will eat a human? It seems like a lot of the questions are related to dangerous snakes or venomous snakes, and I think Allyson will reiterate that's the exception.
Right.
Snakes generally don't look for humans, and it's something that we see in some, you know, television shows, but it's not common.
Right. There are some areas of the world where crocodiles are a danger to people, and people will sometimes get taken down or even eaten by the crocodile, but it's definitely the exception. And what you have to remember is that even in that case, it's because the reptiles were there first, and it's the people that have moved into their habitat. But the important thing to remember about all reptiles is that they have an important place in the world. And probably the reptile that makes the most people nervous is a snake. And I want, if you don't remember anything else, one of the things I want you to remember is that snakes are very important in the food webs and food chains of the world. If there were no snakes in the world to control mice and rats, there would be so many mice and rats running around everywhere that they'd eat up all the food, and there wouldn't be enough food at all for people. And there are also many diseases we can get from mice and rats. So that's another way snakes help us.
Yeah.
So they're much better helpers than they are a danger to anybody. And only about 3% of the snakes in the world are venomous. Most of them are non-venomous. So.
This is a quick one. We'll direct this to you, Sean. How long is the biggest anaconda ever found?
Well, the longest anaconda ever found was on record just over 30 feet long.
30 feet long.
Yeah. The longest snake in the world on record is actually held by the reticulated python from Southeast Asia, and that's at 32 feet 7 inches. Both are comparable almost in length, but the anaconda is quite a bit bigger in size, reaching a weight of over 500 pounds in some cases.
Wow.
Quite a heavy snake.
Here's a question. This is from Matthew at Hoover, and he wants to know, what are the scales of a snake made of? When you feel them, I mean, a lot of people think that they feel slimy, they're very smooth, and what do you know what they're made of?
I'm going to guess and say that they're probably made up The same substances that our nails are.
Fingernails.
Keratin.
Yeah.
Is probably largely what the scales are made up of.
And
but
probably very similar to our skin. It feels a lot, if you feel a reptile skin, it feels a lot like leather. Mm-hmm. And people think that they're slimy because they have this shine. And what I usually say is, well, you see shiny new cars, but you don't see slimy new cars. It's not the same thing.
Yeah.
So you're not going to get anything wet on your fingers or anything like that if you do touch a reptile.
Mike wants to know, how long does a reptile stay in the water? Well, there's some water snakes. How long do they stay in the water? Do they ever come up to land?
Some species, like the yellow-bellied sea snake, will spend its entire life in the water.
Yeah.
It'll only come on land to lay eggs. But for the most part, the yellow-bellied sea snake will spend all of its life in the water.
The same thing is true for a lot of sea turtles. They will spend, as soon as they hatch out, they do have to lay the eggs on land. But when that little baby hatches out and goes for the ocean, it will spend the rest of its life in the ocean feeding there and finding a mate there. And only the females will come back to lay their eggs on shore. But other than that, they're out in the ocean.
I want to put in a little plug for Sean and Allyson. They do presentations to elementary and middle schools and high schools in Jackson, Josephine, and Klamath County. So if you're interested in having them come to your school, you can call the Southern Oregon University Youth Programs, and they do live shows in which they bring some of these same animals with them that they've shared with you today. So if something is of interest to you, you can get a hold of the youth programs at Southern Oregon University and have a live show come to your school. Do you have a question, Allyson?
I do. Jerry, it looks like, was wondering why a rattlesnake's venom can't hurt a king snake. Well, they have what we call an immunity, and Sean probably mentioned that. An immunity just means, just like, you know, some people are allergic to bee stings and some people are not.
Right.
King snakes just happen to have something in their body that keeps the venom from affecting them.
It seems like we could learn a lot from, like, an anti-venom for a rattlesnake that a king snake has, that might be translated into something useful for humans.
Well, they've done some testing area.
Up in the University of Oregon, they have done some research on the shedded skin of king snakes.
Oh, really?
And how it's affected the rattlesnakes. Rattlesnakes can pick up the scent of a king snake and avoid it.
Yeah.
And they found that it has to do with something on their skin.
Right.
Now, but if a king snake gets bitten too many times by a rattlesnake, it will die.
Over.
It doesn't have a complete immunity, only a partial immunity. And so they try to avoid getting bitten, partly because I'm sure it hurts them too. And the way they do this is that they will try to ambush the rattlesnake.
Mm-hmm.
They'll hide and they try to grab it right behind the head so that the rattlesnake is not even able to bite them.
Wow.
So.
What this question is related to the Burmese python, the big python that we had here on the table. How often does it eat, and how long can it go between feedings?
Well, in captivity, we regulate their diets because a lot of times, especially the larger, heavier-bodied snakes tend to be kind of overweight.
Yeah.
And so our snakes are fed about once every week and a half to 2 weeks. Usually the large python will eat between 2 and 5 rabbits.
Rabbits.
Mm-hmm. Pretty big rabbits.
Oh, wow.
Because remember, they can eat something that's 3 times the size of their head. So,
and the
so
reason
you wouldn't
why
think that head could.
Yeah, and the reason why we do feed rabbits is rabbits in this area are raised for human consumption.
Yeah.
And so
right.
It's one of the most readily available sources for food.
Yeah. We've got our iguana over there is looking around for where it can go. It's looking pretty like it wants to go someplace, but the camera people are saying, no, it's just fine right up there.
I have a question here from Jason, and the question is, what is the fastest snake? Have you talked about that already?
Well, I mentioned one of the species of snakes that are really fast, which is also one of the more dangerous snakes. There's a snake in Africa called the African black mamba. I had mentioned to Steve a little bit earlier that the African black mamba, this is a snake that's very dangerous because it'll defend its nesting behaviors. It'll actually defend and chase after people. It can move at about 8 miles an hour. Now, a human being can normally outrun that snake without a problem, but if you think about where an African black mamba lives, the terrain and the bush and the trees, a person couldn't really move over 9 miles
So is there such thing as a hoop snake? I mean, Pecos Bill has hoop snakes where they roll.
You hear all kinds of rumors and myths about snakes, and one of them is that there's a snake that can bite onto its tail and roll down the hill after you.
It doesn't happen.
There is no such snake as a hoop snake. But one of the fastest snakes we have in the United States is a racer. And you can see they get their name because they can be very fast. Yeah. And they can go maybe about 7 miles an hour. But again, people can run a lot faster than that. Racers are not venomous. People think they're going faster usually because they go back and forth so quickly.
Uh-huh.
But from A to B, they're not going that fast.
Okay, I have another question. This question is, how heavy are boa constrictors? You told us about one that can get up to, wasn't a boa constrictor, but can get up to 500 pounds. Mm-hmm. So a boa constrictor like the one up on the line there?
It can weigh in over 100 pounds.
100 pounds.
Yeah, in some cases, maybe up closer to 200 pounds, depending upon the kind of boa constrictor.
Yeah.
But not the largest of the snakes.
Right.
The largest, of course, is still the anaconda. The anaconda is still the largest by...
Here's a question from Ellie. She wants to know, what animals eat snakes?
There are lots of different animals that will eat snakes. Of course, we've already talked about some snakes that eat other snakes, but there are certain types of eagles and hawks that will eat snakes. Owls like to eat snakes.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of different animals, if they get the chance, will take to take a snake for dinner.
Okay. So. Do either of you have a question you want to ask? We're winding down here.
I
want to remind you that if we don't get to all of the questions, we will do so in the 1:30 program.
Sure.
So
try.
We'll try to hit those. We've got a stack of questions that's coming in. We really appreciate your interest in that and the calls that you've made.
Mm-hmm. Mike, I have a question from Mike who asked, what is the most colorful snake? And I would answer that by saying there are several species of colorful snakes, but one of the ones that I think are the most beautiful are the emerald tree boas. And they start out at a young age, really bright yellow coloration, and then as they grow older, they become a real bright red, and then at their adult age, they're a real nice emerald colored green, a real beautiful snake. I think they're one of the most colorful snakes.
And then the coral snakes and the king snakes are some of the prettiest too because of those bright reds and yellows and blacks.
I think we're getting close to the end of the program. We're probably going to have to not take any more questions now until the 1:30 program. Oh, excuse me, we have 2 more minutes, so maybe we can take one more question and then we'll kind of wrap it up, and the remainder we'll try to address at the 1:30 program. So, do you have a question?
Janelle was asking, what's the dumbest reptile? And that question I would answer by saying that dumb is kind of a relative term, maybe. Animals can learn what they need to learn to survive, and a lot of reptiles are born with very many instincts. They know exactly, all reptiles are instinctive animals. As soon as they come out of that egg, they know what kind of food they need to be eating, how they need to heat up, and where they need to live. And so in that sense, they're really pretty smart. And a lot of people are surprised to learn that green iguanas can be litter trained.
Really?
He has a little bowl of water, and when he needs to go to the bathroom, he goes down and goes in that bowl of water, which makes it a lot easier to clean up.
Yeah.
But I don't think we have any IQ tests on reptiles.
Although they've been around for millions of years.
Right. They are, in terms, as biologists, a lot of times we talk about an animal, we measure it by the success of how long it's been on Earth. And in that sense, they're very successful. So they must be doing something right because they've lived for so long and in so many different areas.
We're going to have to wind down the program. I want to thank our two guests today here at Jackson ESD, Sean Nolan on my far left and Allyson McCauley of Southern Oregon University. And they are on a live program that we're calling Animal Tracks, and they also do programs which they come out to the schools. We've had, I don't know, maybe 50 or 60 calls. We've had a lot of calls today. We want to thank you for your interest and the questions that you have. And we'll be back on at 1:30 today, so you can call in and perhaps observe more, ask more questions, and we'll be back with you to share similar information as we've had. Thank you very much for calling. It's really exciting to see your interest in snakes and reptiles in general. And we're going off the air, and we're going to see you then at 1:30 this afternoon. Thank you very much from Jackson Education Service District.